Hi, everybody. I'm Adam Saltsman. I don't have to do an intro anymore, so that's cool. And I'm here to talk to you about this iPad game that we've been working on for about a year now called Hundreds. And it was kind of a big change of pace from how we usually do development. So it's been really interesting for us. I feel like we've learned a lot of lessons. Disclaimer, the game is not actually out yet, so everyone might hate it, in which case, like, these are gonna be really bad lessons. So just take them with a reasonably sized grain of salt. Hopefully, even if it's bad, some of these things will still be valid. So I wanna show, very few people have actually seen Hundreds. There are no videos of it on the internet. It was debuted at IndieCade in California a couple weeks ago, or a week ago, and so I wanted to at least show you guys what this is, since no one's played it, and I'm about to talk about it for a pretty long time. So this is just a short gameplay video. Obviously, it's a cartoon physics game, it's the next Angry Birds, etc. Everything there made tons of sense to everyone, I'm certain. It's back on that slide. Okay, there we go. Okay, is this working? Yeah. Okay, sorry about that. Anyway. So the first thing that was different about Hundreds is the way that the project started and the way that the project was built. Normally, I think of myself as game designer, and I do some prototypes, and then I pick one, and then I tell anyone who will listen, will you make this, or else I'll just make it, and then I'll be like, can you put this on touchscreens so we can make big dump trucks of money. This started out completely different. So this was made, we had four main people on this iPhone, iPad game, which is about twice as many people as we usually have. It sounds like a very small number to a lot of people still probably, but it was definitely different for us. So the first thing I wanted to do is, because I was the only one of the four who could come over here, is I wanted to play a little bit of short intro videos to you guys so you could kind of sort of meet the team even though they're not here. And the first guy is Greg.
Hey, GameCity, I'm Greg. I'm the visual designer and creator of Hundreds. Air quotes, because I made it in Flash a few years ago, just like a tiny little prototype as my first ever coding project that actually was released. And since then, Adam, Eric, Scott, and I have expanded on the concept and actually made it a real game that's playable and really fun, I think. So I'm excited to see what you guys think. Hopefully somebody's taping this or Adam is taking rigorous notes. So, thanks for coming by and enjoy.
You may know Greg from, he designed the indie game, the movie poster. He designed a game called Solipskier. He designed, co-designed a game called Gasketball. He's kind of the greatest dude. and collaborating with him was totally fantastic. Is continuing to be totally fantastic.
Hello, GameCity. I'm Eric. I've been doing a lot of the programming for Hundreds. It's been a lot of fun working with Greg, Adam, and Scott on this project. I knew from the moment I saw Hundreds that it would be a lot of fun to play on the tablet, and I'm really glad that I've had the chance to work on it, the iOS port. Hundreds has been a labor of love. A lot of work has gone into this project. I hope that if you ever get a chance to play Hundreds, that you will notice all the polish and refinement and hard work and effort that we put into it. I hope you enjoyed the talk. Thanks for coming.
That's my business partner, Eric. He was the lead programmer on Cannonballed and Wordle and Gravity Hook and Steambirds and everything that we've put out on the iPhone. And those are his kids running around in the background. Eric and I are both dads now, which makes us pretty weird indie studio at this point, I think. Not as weird as I thought we were, but definitely a little weird. And the last guy is the guy who did all the music and sound.
Hi, my name is Scott Morgan, also known as Loscil. I composed the music and some of the sound effects for Hundreds.
By some, he means like 95%, like basically everything. It's a really amazing guy. Found out about halfway through the project that he was the like lead sound engineer, like the lead sound director guy for Radical, the Vancouver like AAA game studio. That like his day job has been doing like video game sound design for like a decade, but we just thought his electronic music was cool. And I think it was technically Brandon Boyer's idea to work with him on this project. That kind of happens a lot. This is me. My role on Hundreds was doing a lot of it didn't end up being early prototyping. I did a lot of late prototyping. I did a lot of early tuning on the game. I ended up doing a lot of puzzle and game mechanic design and what amounted to, for this game, a lot of the level design, which if you've played any of my games before, you might have noticed they don't actually have levels at all. So that was kind of a weird new thing. And I ended up doing a lot of programming on the iPhone port, which I'm not going to talk about because it's really boring. The idea for this talk is to kind of walk you guys through the actual history of making this game and trying to only talk about the interesting things. If you guys are still awake at the end, it'll mean it worked. It'd be great. If you're asleep, I mean, at least you're getting rest. I think that's really good after last night. So we started talking about making this game back in September. As Greg mentioned, it was initially a Flash game. That he wanted to teach himself to program, and so he basically designed the simplest game that you could possibly design in a lot of ways. It's essentially Asteroids, but there's no ship or bullets. It's just asteroids bouncing around, and you grow them if the mouse overlaps. And the mouse, it's almost similar to BitPilot in some ways, if you guys have played that. It's a really elegant, simple, beautiful game. It's of course beautifully graphic designed because he's Greg. But our version of Hundreds officially began with some short email exchanges. So these are the actual emails that kicked off this project and led to ultimately being nominated for awards and standing here talking to you guys about this thing. I'm not gonna read the whole email out loud if that's cool with you guys. This was Greg's reply, which I like a lot. So this was the actual start of the project. Like this is how serious our like ideation phase is. It was like, oh, all right, Greg's got an iPad now. We got this cool game. Okay, we're good. We were super wrong. So what Eric had built was this extremely simple prototype, which was essentially using Apple UI libraries, like Apple's basically button code or something like that, to make circles bounce around. When you touch them, they turned red, they grew bigger. We had the basic game rules figured out. And that was a really important test because there's no mouse cursor on an iPad. So the question of whether or not this game idea would transfer looked good on paper, but we didn't have technical proof of this. So this very first super simple, poorly performing, not particularly beautiful version of the game was still enough to go, this is valid. Like, not only is this like a reasonable transition, actually the game is different in interesting ways because the Flash version ended up being, anytime the mouse moved over a circle, the circle would get bigger. So the game eventually became a game about dodging circles with the mouse cursor in a lot of ways. And it would get really, really frantic, which is why I compare it to BitPilot sometimes. The iPad game is like way more chilled out. If you didn't want to touch the screen and grow things, you didn't have to. You could just kind of sit there and watch them bounce around. But that also meant that we couldn't just add more circles because you could just be patient. There wasn't this constant time pressure. So if we were going to pursue this and do something, we might have to do something more ambitious. So like I said, the first version of the game, all there was circles. You could touch them, they could grow. They would be randomly generated. When you got the circles to add up to 100, like we saw in the video earlier, it would say, good job, level, you know, N plus one, and it would add one circle. The other problem with this is the difference between level 25 and level 26 becomes basically non-existent. There's no way instantly, visually, or mechanically to tell the difference between 25 circles randomly bouncing around and 26. It's like a 4% change in the level, which is sort of a form of fat that I wanted to trim. So we thought the iPad thing was cool. We started talking to Greg, hey, this feels like something we might want to pursue. So the early idea, the early thought about doing this comes from a bunch of different creative people who I have an immense amount of respect for. One is Chris Hecker, who was here a couple years ago. He's making this game Spy Party, but he's infamous for saying things in public that people hate, like Wii is just two GameCubes duct taped together. But he gave this rant that a lot of people think is like anti-game jams. Game jams are for noobs sort of thing. And it's not really what the rant is about. He says that a little bit because he's Chris Hecker. But what he's really talking about is, wouldn't it be great, and John Blow is somebody who agrees with him, wouldn't it be great if when you found a game that was only scratching the surface of an idea, if you went all the way down that rabbit hole and tried to find all of the interesting expressions of an idea. And Braid's a perfect example of that. It's the actual exact genesis of it is, man, that Prince of Persia time-rewinding mechanic is totally underexplored. Like, think of all the amazing things you could do with that. So those two people and Braid as a game are really inspirational for me and were a big part of why I wanted to make Hundreds. The other game that was really inspirational for me was Sword and Sorcery. So we've been making, I think our first iPhone game, Wordle, came out about 3 years ago when there was only one kind of iPhone. That was it. So we've been in that space for a while and the space has changed a lot. When we launched Cannonball, our launch strategy was, we'll talk about it on Twitter and enough people will buy it from Twitter that it'll get us in the top 100. And then being in the top 100 will guarantee that we get attention. And it totally worked. That was our exact launch plan. It completely worked. Absolutely cannot do that. Like that's not the launch plan for Hundreds. So I was getting super freaked out about what are we gonna do if we make another iOS game, even if it turns out good, how do we tell people about it? How does it work? How do we make sure it stands out from the 450,000 apps or whatever absurd number the ecosystem is at right now? Sword and Sorcery stands out really well. It's drop dead gorgeous, which helps, but it's almost more important is it is iconic unto itself. Like, it doesn't look like anything else. Like, when you see sorcery stuff, you know that you're looking at sorcery. So that was something that we took to heart as well, and that ended up mattering a lot in the long run. So we had our initial technical prototype that we felt pretty good about, and we had this philosophy that we were gonna go deeper than just scratching the surface, and we were gonna find the things that were really special about making this game. And one of the reasons that we like this game is it's just circles bouncing around. So you can put anything in it, you can lay anything on top of it, you can come up with a billion ideas right away with absolutely no effort. And we were like, this is great. We initially were looking at about 3 months of development, 1 to 2 months of testing. It was gonna be a 5-month project. Really, really excited. Had pretty much everything mapped out there. Like, yeah, that's the whole game design. And we started, we have a couple ideas for how to approach some of these gameplay mechanics. So we threw at least half of this stuff away because it wasn't interesting. But one of the other things I'd point out is that, for example, even for game mechanics that we ended up throwing away, there are 5 different ideas for how to communicate the idea that there's a circle type that grows faster than others, and there's a circle type that grows slower than others. Already we're trying to come up with lots of different ways to communicate that idea to people, and that's something that we did a lot in this project that ended up serving us really, really, really well. And part of that's just Greg being a good, disciplined graphic designer, but part of it is this is a game where there's kind of nothing happening most of the time. There's just circles that bounce. There's no explosions. There's no cool particle effects. Like, the few elements that are in this game, we needed to obsess over, or else it was just gonna look cheap. Which I would prefer a design that has fewer moving parts that are perfect than a design that has a lot of moving parts that aren't personally. But it was a pressure that we were already feeling because there's a lot of 99-cent games on the App Store that are insanely polished. And a lot of that polish comes from this really appealing art direction or something like that. And I love our art direction, but appealing is not always gonna be like the first word for like weird clinical, near future, pharmaceutical, whatever it is that we're doing here. So we start feeling pretty good. We're starting to close in on some kind of final icon designs. You can see in the lower right, we've got sort of evolutions of some of the iterations that were in the previous set of icons. And we're thinking, yeah, we're starting to get this figured out. We threw away at least half of this stuff also. Even though we threw away a bunch of stuff, a lot of the sort of the visual language or the visual grammar that was developed in iterating this stuff that we ended up throwing away anyway, ended up paying forward later because we had a really broad visual language already. Like, we had icons we designed, even though we didn't use, that we liked. And that was actually a big help in the long run. So the moral of this whole talk is it's okay to throw everything away because you learn from it, I guess. That's just what I'm gonna talk about this whole time. So at this point in the project, for game mechanics, like you saw in the last couple pages, there's tons of different circle types. They're all gonna have different behaviors when you touch them, when they bounce into each other, different crazy things are gonna happen. And I really like that. That's exactly what we wanted to do with Hundreds. We wanted to say, okay, there's circles bouncing around, that's fine, but we need to have more types of behavior in order for the puzzles to be interesting and for the game to be able to survive this problem where you can't tell the difference between 25 circles and 26 circles. And we want to have more than 5 puzzles in the game. Something that we did not realize at the time but ended up being a serious problem is almost none of these behaviors overlapped or interacted in an interesting way. You know, a classic example of interesting video game systems are games like Thief or Spelunky, which happen to be action games instead of puzzle games, but they have these overlapping properties and systems that are really interesting. So a rock in Spelunky can do multiple things, including killing yourself, killing enemies, bouncing off walls, triggering traps, which fire arrows, which then can hit you. Like, that rich overlap results in emergent behavior, which is a really positive thing. And I'll talk about that some more. Those are not things we realized at this time. We didn't look at the game and go, all right, we have a serious problem, guys. There's no like really interesting emergent behavior from all of our game mechanics. We looked at our game, we were like, this is awesome. We started doing level design. There's gonna be a lot of scans like this where I'm just trying to plan out puzzles that will somehow be sort of pedagogical but not condescending and will slowly introduce new concepts. Lots of like not mind-blowing puzzle game, you know, approaches at all, but this is the way that I opted to approach it, and then I thought worked pretty well was to just make these tiny diagrams that are a little bit bigger than a postage stamp, because I could do a whole bunch of them really, really fast, and if I had a bad idea, I didn't have to worry. I wasn't throwing out a whole bunch of, like a whole level design file that I'd been working on for 2 days. I just like would put a big X through it and just like make a fart noise with my mouth and like go on and draw the next square. And it was, that ended up being really important. And more or less by chance, this is almost exactly how the game starts. So this scan, this is from like October of 2011, the introductory set of levels and the way that the game teaches you how to play itself is almost exactly like this. It's pure luck. At this point, nothing had changed much in the game engine except Eric built us this thing where we could put up text files full of level data up onto our own FTP server or whatever. And as long as we gave the file the right file name, then we could click on it in Mobile Safari and it would launch hundreds with that new level data. So it wasn't as good as being able to edit level data live within the game somehow, but it was really easy to add. We were already loading level data, adding web code to load level data that was debug only and so didn't have to be nice. It was like less than a page of code, and we were able to prototype the levels much faster. So it was not an ideal solution, but it was a pretty, for how cheap it was, it made a really big difference, especially in the beginning of the game where a lot of these things are not level design, they're the whole game feel. All the major parameters of the game, the speed at which things move, the rules by which they collide and stuff like that are all encoded in here. So we could just tweak a file on our FTP program, hit save, refresh hundreds, and now we have different physics. That made a process that could have been long and laborious and horrible way, way, way more tolerable. At this point, I'm jazzed. I'm just like, man, this is awesome. We got this like FTP thing going on. I'm gonna make a million levels. So I'm just like thumbnailing, this thing, these guys go up here. There's like awful puzzles down there. About half of these levels, I think, survive maybe. Just million levels forever. But notice there's like a thing that's sort of happening here where these are like really, really simple levels. There's a lot of random motion. You can see the word random written around here. And then not much randomness going on. It's becoming like really, really rigid. And it's becoming like super complex and rigid and like obsessive. And at this point, I'm still thinking like, yeah, this is awesome. This is totally how we're gonna design this game, because the thing with hundreds is it's always random. There's just circles bouncing around everywhere. And we are game designers, which means we are going to design this experience for humans to have. And we're gonna design these puzzles, or we're gonna have this braid-like. Braid was one of our inspirations. We wanted to be able to construct these puzzles that people would fiddle with and experiment with and have a small epiphany. And then and that would come from, you know, creating a really deliberate puzzle that had a deliberate idea behind it. This turned out to be a pretty bad idea, but we were totally all about this. This was way, way, way the hardest part of this project. It wasn't the longest or like the most stressful, but um, basically were making the wrong game, and we submitted it to the IGF and got two honorable mentions. One of them wasn't even in the mobile category. So we weren't even in our own ghetto. Like, we got an honorable nomination in a real category for innovation with a lot of puzzles that are actually designed like wrong and coming from the wrong place. So now we're feeling really good about how we're designing this game. So getting encouragement when we weren't, when we hadn't figured out the right path, I don't think was really positive. The thing that was positive is that even months later, once we realized that there were some things that we could do better, this was actually still really encouraging, because it meant, like, we were looking at, we're like, man, when this thing was tiny and broken and awkward, people were still into it. So maybe all this effort that we pour into improving and loving this work and trying to elevate this work, like, it was easier to believe that that would pay off, that that would be meaningful to the people who were gonna play this game eventually. So that was actually a pretty big source of motivation for us, even though it kind of caused a problem, which is, like I said, we're really gung-ho about this. We're like, okay, we got 5 or 6 game mechanics, let's come up with some more. These may not look super complicated, but essentially these are mostly theoretical ideas. These are not ideas that end up translating well to little thumbnail level designs like I'll show. I'm super excited. I'm super misguided at this point. This ends up being okay. All of our best ideas in the game directly evolve from this list of horrible ideas. It just takes like months to happen. You can kind of see the continuing trend of just really complicated. This is my favorite one. This one up here is, this requires like 3 new whole game mechanics, at least 2 of which are so complicated that we haven't even figured out how to start prototyping them. And it's used for like 3 levels. Those are all the ideas that we can come up with for this thing. And I still think it's a pretty good idea at this point. Is the worst idea. So this is like, in these, you can see there's like these little circles with like a F, and there's like an arrow. So that was my notation for factory circles. These aren't even necessarily alternate ideas, but these are alternate modes for visualizing the modes that the factory circles could run in within each of the puzzles. Like, I thought this was the coolest idea. Like, this was definitely the future of our game. At the same time, the whole game was rewritten to use, to be drawn on just the graphics chip in the iPad. So instead of using textures for the circles, or instead of using even procedural geometry necessarily, which we tried, and instead of using whatever like OpenGL backend the Apple UI stuff uses, Eric started writing this code that would procedurally generate all the triangles you needed to have a basically circular shape, and then just on the edge would run do the actual math for doing actual screen space anti-aliasing just in this little strip around the edge of the circle, because there was no way to get the circles to look as good as we needed them to look and have it run smoothly we needed it to look perfect, because again, it's just circles. If anybody's super techie, we tried MSAA, which is also, I think, basically the same as oversampling, which is essentially, oh, you need anti-aliasing, just draw the game really, really, really big and then shrink it down every frame. Performance was really bad, and it actually didn't look nearly as good as our shader program either. At this point, we're actually really excited, because now circles can be any size we want. They look great. We're doing this, like, we can do an actual procedural vignette effect, even on iPad 1, which is basically impossible. Like, on iPad 1, if you don't know, if you try to draw a thing in front, like, Cannonball on iPad 1, like Cannonballs is the laziest game in the world. There's like building layers of buildings going into the background to create a cool parallax effect. On iPad 1, those buildings stop at the pixel where they can no longer be visible behind the other buildings, just so the computer doesn't have to draw those pixels over again, just because the iPad can't do it fast enough. So we wanted to have a vignette effect because, again, it's just circles bouncing around. We need something to make it slightly more visually rich. But if you take a alpha mapped vignette and you lay it on top of your game on an iPad 1, it won't run anymore, which was not ideal. So this enabled us to do a bunch of stuff. So at this point, yeah, like we're like, man, our technology is awesome. Our game design is awesome. Secretly, the game design is not awesome at all. And this is like, you know, we're 3 or 4 months into the project at this point, which means we're about a month beyond where we wanted to launch the game, which means a couple of things. It means, one, I'm really not good at planning. It means, two, doing exploratory game design does not lend itself well to planning in some ways. And the only way that we were able to continue approaching the game this way is Cannonball was in a Humble Bundle. That's the thing that's allowed us to keep the lights on while we continue this process. So, but this is also when making the game started to get really, really good. Because we were about, we're close to 6 months into working on this game at this point, which means a lot of the stuff that we'd made really early on in the project and we were still really personally connected to during the winter holidays and winter months, 2011, 2012, by March, they look like pieces of the game that were made by some other idiot that you didn't even know. So you could open up a level and just be like, who designed this? This is horrible. And it was me, you know? So Hundreds has a lot of problems at this point, like I've been talking about. The puzzles are very rigid, and they're not that interesting. The game is behind schedule. We don't actually have that many puzzles in the game. The game is about 30 puzzles at this point, but it's called Hundreds. So it kind of needs to have 100 puzzles, right? There's nothing that looks like it's going to work soon. My confidence in the project is actually pretty good at this point because I'm starting to figure out some ideas, which I'm going to talk about in a minute. But there's no actual concrete solutions. Like, we don't have a list at this point, similar to that crazy list from a few slides ago of these are the things that are going to make this game great. We still don't have that. So, like I said, I'm actually really confident that we're going to solve the problems, even though we haven't yet. And I feel really good about that, but we haven't solved the problems yet, and I feel really bad about that. So, we go back and we start playing Greg's original Flash game, which is just bouncing circles. It doesn't have any of, there's no fixed rigid puzzles, there's no rotating factory mode circle production system. There's no magnets. There's no mass-based collisions. And it's really, really fun. Like, the Flash game is like way more fun than the iPad game at this point. And that's really not where we wanted to be about a month after the iPad game was supposed to come out. And there's something about the iPad game that's still working, but it's not working. Like, I feel weird about it. Greg, I can tell, feels weird about it, but is trying to be really polite. It's like, he made Hundreds, he understood what he was doing when he made it, and I'm sort of there being like this kind of like, we're gonna make this braid puzzly thingy, and this is how it's gonna go. And anyway, we return to the source material, and we start noticing a couple of things about it that for us are the things that we love about it, that are not the problems that we're trying to fix, that are not the thing that we need to explore more deeply. The two things that we love are the game is simple and it's random. The randomness is actually really good. The randomness makes you improvise when you play. The randomness is really interesting. But it can't be completely random, and so we start to figure that out later. the thing that we notice is that in the iPad version, there's very little randomness and there's very little simplicity. The ideas are increasingly complex with no payoff, and the levels are very rigid. So, and the problem was all of our remaining ideas were very rigid and very non-random, which meant that all the content had to be very deliberately designed, and the game's already behind schedule. So we started thinking, you know, what if we embrace this is our genius epiphany about the project. What if we actually focus on the things that make this game actually fun and are easy to do? Wouldn't that be way better than this approach that we've been doing? This means, you guys are familiar with the phrase killing babies, killing your babies, killing your darlings, is the idea that you have almost always have ideas in your project that kind of don't belong there, but they're your ideas, so they have inherent value for you. And so we started killing babies, and we start finding our groove again, which is great. We go through and we kill some of the really overcomplicated stuff. We change the physics system to be less realistic, but somehow more intuitive. And we're feeling really, really good about it, except now the game is about half the size that it was. And the main problem we had is that the game is way too small to begin with. So at this point, we're down to about 15 puzzles that are really good. And now we're like 4 to 8 weeks behind release, which is a little bit uncomfortable place to be in. The thing that ends up working really well for us and being really interesting for us in trying to figure out where do we go from here, now we have a game that's smaller than it's ever been, is to revisit that crazy list from earlier. Revisit this list here, but doing it through a lens of simplicity. So look at, take each of these ideas. Each of these ideas came from a place that was actually reasonable. These are just horrible expressions of that reasonable, core, interesting idea. Like, we hadn't actually iterated on, the same way that we would iterate on those icon designs, these ideas did not get that level of attention or that amount of due diligence. So a lot of these things ended up leading to new things that are actually really important. So there was these blue circles bouncing around that were freezing other circles in the video earlier, and those came out of this horrible idea for time bombs. And the whole idea of time bombs is nothing in the game was, it's a multi-touch game, but there was nothing in the game that wanted you to keep fingers on the screen at the same time, but nothing's growing. It's not a risk thing, it's just like a thing that you can do with people's fingers, and we didn't have a thing asking them to do that. Time bombs were like the most complex way of getting people to do that. And something that's much easier and simpler is, oh, the circles are frozen, you touch them with your body temperature finger, and it slowly unfreezes them. So same thing, way easier to prototype, way easier to code, way easier to design levels around. And unlike the time bomb, it begins to have emergent behavior, which we'll talk about in a second. The same thing, there was gonna be these drain circles that were gonna be like sort of these AI that would go around and find big circles and like suck like stuff out of them, like Brownian motion and cellular microscopes and things were one of the sort of background inspirations for some of the look and feel of this game. And we thought, that'd be cool, they could go around and drain. It's so hard to do, it's so not worth it. And so we end up with the saw blades that you saw in the video where they bump into a circle. If the circle has any points, now it has zero. And it's basically achieving exactly what we wanted the drain thing to be able to kind of like work against you. So you had an opposing force, but one that you was easy to understand the rules and you could manipulate in some ways, and saws fit that really well. And this allowed us to also, now that we're thinking about things not so much in terms of themed behavior, but the core nugget behavior of what the thing is, we're actually able to synthesize new ideas of overlapping things. Like, what if there's something that you have to press and hold, but it also kind of like loses its points? And that became something that we call the infected circles, which were like the simplest but last and one of the most interesting things that ever went into the game. So we're starting to come up with some cool game mechanics, and the thing that is sinking in for me at this point is that I've been thinking about, I've been sort of inspired by Braid the wrong way and by Chris Hecker in the wrong way. And when people tell you, oh man, there's so much potential in this idea, there's so many interesting things you can do with this, your job isn't actually to go find everything that you can do with it. It's to go find the right or the interesting things to do with it, which again, probably should have been obvious to us in the beginning. It certainly sounds obvious now, but it very much wasn't, especially with an idea that had so much room to add new things to it. So for us, it was ultimately, a lot of our early ideas were, there's circles bouncing around. So this game is about circles bouncing around. So the vector that we're gonna take as we explore the wilderness around this game is the bouncing circles vector. And it turns out that's not what makes Hundreds interesting at all. It was what we realized months later, it's simplicity and randomness that made Hundreds actually interesting. And when we explored that vector out into the wilderness, then we started to find interesting things. And it's around this time of development that we come up with our own word for referring to, without even consciously realizing it. These are all retrospective epiphanies in a lot of ways. We start talking about the way we're designed. We're like, you know, we could use more of these classic puzzle designs, referring to levels that we designed that felt more like the Flash version of Hundreds. And so that actually, even our level design, in our level data file, there are still comments saying classic style level with ingredients X, Y, and Z. Because that was our internal nomenclature for these like entropic or Brownian puzzles that just felt right, even though we didn't clearly understand at the time why. The thing that we started finding that I was really enjoying when we were doing our puzzle designs is moving away from these kind of rigid puzzles and moving into puzzles where you always, every time you play this level 65 or something like that, you always have the same ingredients. There's always four of these saw blades, there's one ice circle, there's two of those guys with the red stripes, and there's a few normal circles. Every time you play that level, it's the exact same ingredients, but every time you play it, they will start in a different place with different velocities. And that ended up being the thing that was the right balance for us between total randomness and designing a puzzle experience. Because in our game, it turns out that the process of simply selecting the ingredients is the level design that is at the core of making this game. So the level design is not, you need to put these pinball bumpers here, here, and here. It's up a whole level where it's like, the ratio in which you include things with different behaviors yields these emergent and overlapping interesting things. And you can actually see it. It'll be in the release game. You will actually feel and play the game transitioning from rigid puzzles to these looser, more random puzzles. This is a quote that I probably did wrong, but that I really like, and that was a principle that we were essentially rediscovering during this phase of development, which is this idea that the randomness versus skill is a false dichotomy or a false axis, and that really interesting games are really random and really skillful, and the skill of the game is about learning how to cope with the randomness of the situation that you're in. That's the first time that I'd heard it crystallized was from Frank Lance, who's the designer on Drop 7, and a sort of a warrior, poet, genius, game designer guy. We take away a lot of the ideas that we had at the beginning of the game. We threw away these things called contagious circles. We threw away fast circles. We threw away slow circles. We threw away holes. We threw away magnets. We threw away bombs. We threw away everything that was in that giant list of stuff that was actually really easy to throw away because we never figured out how to implement it. And we ended up, this was the craziest thing. We really kind of only added three new game mechanics to the game. After we had killed all of our babies and our game had shrunk down to a size that we were not comfortable at all with, we were panicking about, we've only got 20 puzzles, this isn't a game. Adding just a few new game mechanics led to enough emergence to build 100 valid puzzles with very little fat to trim. Or at least got us close. These are some early level designs for the new freeze or ice circle behavior that we think is interesting, and for the saw blade behavior that we think is sort of interesting. Not many of these ended up surviving, but this one survived. That one was deemed too similar to this one. That one I just axed like a week ago. That one totally survived up there. I think I got some icy ones. Let's see. Oh yeah, so this is, oh great, we're feeling really good. Okay, saw blades is perfect, but we still have to actually design them and figure out how they're gonna look. And they end up looking pretty close to like this column here. Is more or less what we settle on. Everything else feels too complex and the visual language is too confusing. If red circles aren't supposed to touch, this thing has red triangles, but they only reduce things to zero. They don't cause an instant game over. Maybe that's kind of not what we want to do. We start fiddling around with ideas for what should this circle that can freeze other circles, what should that look like? And this was like the most controversial thing in the whole game, was whether we should add blue to the game's color palette. It so far only had red and gray. But we felt like the game mechanic was interesting enough and cross-cut through all the other game mechanics that we had to go ahead and do it. So like I said before, these cross-cutting behaviors are creating emergent behavior. So out of this idea that the thing that made Hundreds interesting is it's simple and it's random. The reason that that's ultimately interesting, I think, is because of emergence. The proof of this for us is we started looking at our levels and our level designs and some of our new game mechanic ideas, all of which I ended up programming because Eric was busy building the game engine and stuff, is I had to actually like start going, okay, so there's circles that bounce around and you can only grow the circles if you touch both at once and they're joined by a line. That's a very simple idea that's presented early in the game. What happens if one circle gets frozen? I'm like, I don't actually know. We're gonna make an informed decision that we think is an intuitive expression of those two mechanics overlapping, make sure it's supported in the game engine, but then actually go and design a puzzle about that, because that's a weird emergent thing that we didn't expect from the game mechanic. There are circles that have a negative number that counts against your score, and if you touch them, they shrink instead of growing. That's interesting, but what if a saw touches it? The circle has non-zero. Should it go to negative 100 or should it go to zero? And it turns out it's actually really interesting if it goes to zero, because now you want saws to go pop these negative number circles. So now the saw is actually really interesting and good if it's near negative numbers, and really horrible and bad if it's near positive numbers. And that's like three different puzzles that are interesting expressions of that. We have circles that are always red, even if you're not touching them. How do they behave when they get around some of these other circle types? The saws that drain points away, we have these like soap bubbles in the game that you can kind of pop with your finger. Should saws just like mow them down? Because they're just bubbles. Why would a saw bounce off a bubble? And it doesn't make any sense, which is bad, but if they can bounce off bubbles, then suddenly bubbles are really interesting, where before they just kind of take up space and you want to get rid of them. If you have some circles that you're trying to grow bigger and there's some saw blades over here and there's some bubbles in the middle, all of a sudden these bubbles are serving a real purpose and you want to sort of curate the way that you pop them to give yourself just enough room to grow your circles while still providing some kind of barrier between you and this saw blade thing. And what happens with saws and ice? Maybe if ice hits the saws freeze just like the circles with points. That's cool. Now ice is good and not annoying because it's shutting down these saws. But what if, what happens when a saw touches a circle that's been frozen? Well, I guess it just bounces off, and that's not interesting. But what if the circle has a bunch of points? Now you actually want it to get frozen, because yeah, you can't grow it, but the saw is going to bounce off it and not pop it anymore. So that's an interesting puzzle that we can build. And what we ended up with is essentially with 8 game rules, we only had about 30 puzzles, and we went up to 10 or 11 game rules that were way more emergent and overlapping. We had about 90 puzzles, which was awesome. Like, that was the overall level of panic on the project started to come way, way, way down right about then. The game is nowhere close to done, but we're like moving out of this panic period. It also let us do something really, really cool, which is invent. As soon as these circles started overlapping in really interesting ways, the potential for doing a more random or more procedural type of game started to emerge, where it wouldn't, we could potentially program an algorithm that would go randomly select obstacles for you, and they would overlap in an emergent, interesting way that you would have to react to and improvise with, which is not, if you just randomly go and take any of the game mechanics from the first half of development and throw them in a room together, they're kind of automatically not interesting. It's not any more interesting than a puzzle that's been deliberately designed, because it's just sort of things that have no relation to each other. So we feel really, really good about this. This is back in March. Like, basically the core gameplay is done, and the game itself is maybe only halfway done, which is a kind of a horrible feeling. We have some problems. We have 90 puzzles, which is great, but we don't have 100. So do we want to add a whole new game mechanic or game rule to the game to get us up to 100, but deal with the fact that now we're complicating the game? There's more than one game mechanic per set of 10 levels. Are we just cluttering it? How are we going to get around this? What happens when you beat the game? Like, we have a set of 100 puzzles. Does the game just like, does it like Ghostbusters you and be like, thanks for playing a great game? We have to do an immense amount of work on the user interface and menus and all these other things. We also decided to completely rebuild the game engine from scratch, which was sort of a horrible process in a way, but ended up being really, really important. Our OpenGL shader GPU like procedural circle stuff was really, really awesome. It was really great for things that only had to do exactly what we were doing in gameplay. And it was extremely rigid and inflexible and couldn't cope with anything else. So if we wanted to do like some kind of cool menu animation where, like, I don't know, a button moved in from the side of the screen instead of simply existing, it was like half a page of code or something. It was pretty difficult. So rebuilding the game engine allowed us to do things like that in like 2 lines of code. And so suddenly we could start building some really rich user interface elements that existed in between the segments of more austere, simple gameplay. But it also allowed us to make the gameplay a little bit more rich by having bubbles don't just disappear when they pop. There's like a little bit of an animated ring. And that animated ring is actually procedurally animated on the GPU using the stuff that was built during this phase. Fix some frame rate problems. It was a good thing to do, but it took most of the summer. There was a bunch of stuff that wasn't actually designed yet. We had all the game mechanics down for these infected circles that I talked about earlier, but in the game they were just green circles, and that was not deemed nice for looking at with your eyes. We didn't want to add in another color. Ice already had its own color. We didn't want to keep going down that road. And so we started thinking about what are some different ways that we could design this. And some of these ideas we loved. I especially like these kind of like the one on the far upper right, where it sort of looked like it's kind of like just damaged. But our procedural GPU rendered stuff couldn't actually do that. So that had to be chucked, and we had to try out some other things. We ended up using sort of a very, there's some circles that just have like a white ring just on the inside. There's about three of them. We used sort of a variation on that eventually. And one of the things that happened in this phase of development is we started feeling really, really good about the different game mechanics that were falling out, this emergent overlapping of things. And we started thinking a lot about what would the end of the game be like. And I'm not going to say that here, but it was a lot of the things that we came up with were great, and we were only able to come up with them after fixing the stuff that we had fixed before this phase. Everything good that happened after we had this very slow realization about what made Hundreds an actual interesting game. So this process, this whole phase of things, of working really hard on a game that's mostly designed already and not having a lot to show for it, took like 3 or 4 months. And we don't really have a lot to show for it. This is a work hole, which is how I describe this part of the process. We were just in a work hole. It was necessary to do to get the game at the level that we wanted it, but it was still a work hole. And at the same time, in the middle of work hole, we start having some serious concerns, not about the game design, but about telling humans about our game design, because our game looks like this. Like if our game was on the App Store right now and you went to the App Store and you're like, I've been hearing great things about this game Hundreds, that's the screenshot that you would see. Like, what is it? If there was no video before, like this would look either like pretty pretentious art, or I think some people would get it. They would go, oh, this is some kind of number spatial thing. Maybe this is cool. But it doesn't tell them anything about how this game works or what it does. And that was a thing that I never worried about much with something like Cannonball. Like, Cannonball is really deliberately designed. Take a screenshot whenever you want. There's freaking giant aliens in the background. There are collapsing skyscrapers all around you. There's a dude running as fast as he can. Like, it's all there in every screenshot of that whole game. We don't have that here. That's not to say that I think this looks bad. I think it's beautiful. I love Greg's graphic design. But it doesn't communicate anything about this game that we've, at this point, been working on for nearly a year. And this is starting to make us feel kind of uncomfortable, because it's like, great, 3 or 4 people spending a year on this thing that they love and they think is beautiful, and this is our number one idea right now of convincing people that they should give us some of their time to play the puzzles that we designed. So in the middle of dealing with this problem, Greg, who introduced himself earlier, launched his game Gasketball. Not exaggerating, like, Gasketball is one of the great async multiplayer game designs on the iPhone. It's a competitive level design game where you send these like pinball levels back and forth to each other. It's totally brilliant. It did really bad. It somewhat infamously made both Mike and Greg homeless for a short period. They spent 2 years working on it, and it did not connect with people, even though it's a great design. And in the middle of working on Gasket Ball, one of Greg's other projects he is graphic designing is a Vlambeer game called Ridiculous Fishing, which was like notoriously cloned by some horrible jerk-offs in a game called Ninja Fishing or something like that. Greg is somewhat gun-shy about making things at this point. For Eric and I, we haven't actually put a new game on the App Store in about 2 years. We released Gravity Hook and Steambirds like 18 months ago or something like that, I think. It's been a while. And those games didn't do particularly well. The last game that we released on the App Store that did well that we made was Cannibal. And that was, I think, like 3 years ago now. I think it was like GameCity like 3 years ago. So I'm not feeling super confident about just putting this game out in the wild either. But more than financially, we feel like there are these kind of, like I was talking about earlier, I guess, that, like, we have emotional stakes in this project. Like, we've been putting a lot of thought into how to build this thing and make it something that almost anybody can play and almost anybody can have the same little series of epiphanies. And it's this like thing that we feel so good about and we've put in front of a really wide variety of playtesters and everybody's having this great connection with it. And you know, it looks like this. So emotionally, it would be really, really hard to do that kind of, I guess, due diligence on a work that you consider fit for human consumption and have it not consumed by humans. Even if it was a free game, which we actually discussed, which I'll get to, we like desperately wanted people to at least try it. If it wasn't people's style, like if the circles are just too boring and you want something that's like more visually rich or more action oriented, like I don't care about those people. If they don't like Hundreds, it's fine. Well, what we didn't want is for people who really wanted a game like Hundreds, like a game that wasn't gonna put pressure on them but was gonna require their brain to do some exercise and to think about things in a new way. We wanted them to know about the game. So, like I said, everybody that's played the game at this point is really enjoying it, even though the game doesn't have tutorials, even though it doesn't have cartoon birds, even though it doesn't have like box 2D, people are really liking it. And we've tried to design it in a way that it would be friendly toward a really wide audience, where it'd be challenging, but challenging in a way that wasn't necessarily predicated on an existing grasp of a specific game genre or a specific game mechanic or anything like that. It has some cool, weird, implicit cooperative play where when we would bring it to beer nights and somebody would be playing the game over here and people just reach over onto the iPad and start playing their game while they're playing it and usually killing them. But even that is kind of like a fun experience for everybody. So there's this truism that the first or most important step in marketing your game is to actually make a game that people actually like. And we still don't know if we've actually done that, but we begin over the summer to start to think like, I don't think the game was there yet, but now we think it is. We took a game that people did respond to well at the IGF last year, threw away all the bad stuff, and added a bunch more good stuff. And everybody we put it in front of, including my 60-year-old cowboy uncle, taught my 90-year-old grandpa to play the game when we were road tripping this summer, right? Like, it's got this really good, these are not gamers. It's got this broad reach and we feel really good about it. And so we think like, okay, the game is okay. The game itself is, we're running out of ideas about how we want to make it better and still be true to what it is. But what can we do to tell people about it? So our plan this summer kind of fell into these categories. The first is the Spell Tower website, which was Our friend Zach, Zach Gage, made this great word game, Spell Tower, 6 months ago, maybe 8 months ago, I can't remember. And his friend made this amazing website for Spell Tower. So if you go to, I'm assuming it's spelltower.com. It's just this gorgeous website that is not a normal video game website. Like, it's not a bunch of screenshots and like a big buy now button and some other thing with like an explosion and like a cartoon like woman with a sword on the side of the screen. It's just like this elegant, beautiful, the typography is perfect. It's got these like little videos and animations, and sometimes as you scroll, things will kind of like swim in from the side, and it's just absolutely beautiful. And the game actually got press, not for how good the game is designed, which it is, but for how good the web page was designed. Like, press outlets were writing about this beautiful web page, which is a really weird idea that we kind of liked. And you guys should totally play Spell Tower also, it's super good. And we like this approach for marketing. We think this is great. This is not pushy. It's not a freemium in-app purchase thing. There's not a huge risk. Like, making a really nice web page is ultimately not nearly as expensive as buying months of ad banner space with some company X, Y, or Z. The trick is, it has to be a super awesome website, which is certainly not something that I was going to do. One of our other options was making a freemium game. And this was something that we thought about really, 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 really seriously, because screenshots, not great. People play the game on an iPad, totally love it. So this seems like a really good fit for something that's essentially has an express mode or a light mode or a demo mode where people can play it and have this little epiphany, not about a specific puzzle, but about, oh, it's just circles, but that's good. I'm glad it's just circles. This is fantastic. It ended up, we felt like it created more problems than it solved. One, freemium is not this for most games. For Gasketball, which was a freemium game, it was the opposite of this. It was hobos. So imagine this, only there's no money, and instead of that guy, there's hobos. That happens for a lot of games. Even though they're freemium, the future of whatever. And yeah, probably that means that they weren't designed correctly, but the freemium games that tend to make a lot of the games that do that are doing design things that we weren't comfortable with doing anyway. So if we were gonna do freemium, we were gonna try and do it right, ethically, whatever. And games that do that frequently don't get to do this. So that was a concern about doing freemium. We were concerned about how much of the game to give away for free and how much to keep behind this so-called paywall. So we had 100 levels that are this kind of complete, almost like a really, really long tutorial with no words or something. They like guide people through this series of discoveries and a process of learning about the game. Where do we cut that off? Is it like level 25? Is that the good spot? And then that leaves us with kind of a weird problem, because now we're not actually selling a game with 100 levels, we're selling a game with 75 levels, which feels sort of weird. There is actually a little bit of overhead in adding in-app purchases to your game. You need an actual interface where people can go and buy the game. And part of this game, part of the pleasure of this game, is it has a very unified and diegetic interface where there aren't a lot of things reaching in. Like, one of our way early on the project, there was a Google Doc that said, at the top, it just said something like, Ender's Game meets, like, folding. Which, I don't know if you guys know folding. It's like the protein folding online collaborative science thing. And Ender's Game is these kids play these, you know, future games that are kind of like complex space simulators. We wanted to find something in the middle, which was like, let's visually, the thing that's going to unify this game, one of the things that's going to unify it is it's going to look like you're playing with some sort of weird, wiggly science interface from the future that is supposed to be a hologram. You know, you've got circles over here that you're touching and doing those, and you're turning this thing on and off, and there's Brownian motion, and it's none of it's real science, but all of that stuff was part of the reason that we had taken the risk of spending a year working on the game is we thought those things were beautiful. And figuring out where we were gonna fit in the upsell screen was a solvable problem, but was an actual design problem. Would it be themed around the like hundreds world, which is only hinted at? Would it use the currency of that world when it talked to you, or would you just get like a game center thing that pops up and is like, buy now for $2.99? It felt kind of weird. And there's also some things you have to do to make sure that you have Apple's approval when you do a freemium or in-app purchase game, which is the game has to be a quote, complete experience even without the unlockable items. And so doing a version of the game that only had 20 levels might have been complicated by that too. So after Gasketball came out and didn't maybe do as good as a lot of us thought it was going to, Mike and Greg, who are the creators of Gasketball, went on a road trip across the US, and they basically left from Baltimore and drove to Seattle. And they were in Montana, I think, so they'd been on the road for about 3 or 4 days at this point, and I get this email from Greg. So, like, this is sort of like the level of desperation that we're at regarding this as an actual problem for the game. And part of this is exacerbated by Gasketball not doing well and by us not having a big successful game on the App Store recently. But like, this was actually contemplated. Like, I got this email and I didn't even respond right away because I was talking to my wife, Becca, and I was like, you know, we could do this. Like, we could chuck all this, like, all this GPU stuff. Nobody's gonna notice it anyway. We're gonna make it Fish, and it's gonna be called Fish Pop, and it's gonna be a freemium game with level packs, and we are gonna live in a sky fortress. Ultimately, there's two things for me. One was, it just felt awful. Like, we had spent a year trying to make this beautiful thing, and to make it unbeautiful is not the reason that, it's not the reason you spend a year of your life on something. If you're gonna spend a year doing a thing, like, make the beautiful thing, and if you have to get a real job after that, do that instead. At least then you made a beautiful thing. But also, I think from a business perspective, and this is the Sword and Sorcery influence and the Nathan Vella influence, from the very beginning of the project, is we wanted part of our actual survival strategy and the way that we wanted to stand out and be noticed was to make something that didn't look like everything else. Because honestly, at this point, if we had turned it into Fish Pop, we would have actually been competing for attention with other cartoon physics animal games. And we don't have the resources to do that. We weren't about to start putting out 200 level, you know, DLC packs made by our Ukraine studio, right? Like, that's not a thing that we could do. So our strength was to kind of stay weird. So unfortunately, this pretty much means our big marketing plan is to make a really cool website. It's sort of working out, but at this point, we actually have no idea what to organize the site around. Like, Spell Tower has this like really beautiful look, and the way the Spell Tower is organized is fairly straightforward, I think, because it's essentially it uses the visual language of a crossword puzzle, and so the way that the site expresses itself is just kind of a beautiful, like, quasi bookstore, Starbucksy, just like, thing. It's just pretty, and it's about words, and it's about the game being simple, and it's really nice. And we didn't know what to do for our game because our game has all of these competing things. It's got simple visuals, but it's got complex puzzles and complex problems to solve. And so about a week after the fish pop email, Greg and I had a really good series of emails where we decided that, you know, we're trying, basically trying to figure out part of what Sword and Sorcery did that was really effective for Sword and Sorcery is it kind of went out and sought out art snobs a little bit. And I think it was a really good idea. It's a really beautiful game, and it got a lot of people who are not normally super excited about video games to be really excited about this video game. And so Sword and Sorcery never even calls itself a video game, right? It's an interactive audiovisual experience or something along those lines, but something that sounds better than that. We wanted to reach a different audience, like not necessarily Sword and Sorcery audience hopefully overlapped our audience, but our audience also had like young children and moms and grandparents and these people who have an allergy to things that they perceive, rightfully or not, as art snobbery, or people that we thought would actually enjoy our games. You don't have to be an art snob to get something out of it. I am an art snob for what it's worth. And the thing that we decided on was that something about Hundreds was meditative or zen or something. We had this chilled out soundtrack. There's a basic game design principle in Hundreds, which is if you don't mess with the level, it'll be stable. You'll see a beautiful geometric animation. The system is only going to destabilize when you interact with it. And you can stop interacting anytime you want because there's no mouse cursor. You can just watch the game and try and get a feel for it and think about what you're doing when you play it. And we thought that this, our hope was that this wouldn't turn off people who are into first-person shooters because we're not saying casual. You know, this isn't like a game for, this isn't a game for wussies. You know, it's just it's a game that is about intentionally relaxing a little bit, but we never go all the way and say it's easy. And for people who maybe would be intimidated by, you know, if we really deliberately followed up, we wouldn't have done a Sword and Sorcery art thing probably, but we may have tried to pursue almost like a math snob angle, where we'd be like, you know, check out this great game. It's about, there are puzzles that are about epiphanies, about angles of incidence, and like the effects of a changing radius in an enclosed space, and the consequences of that when there are multiple objects moving, and it's inspired by Brownian motion and cellular biology. And like that was a legitimate angle, but I think, there's a lot of people who maybe that's not exactly what they're looking for when they pick up a game to play it, is they're looking for like a pleasant puzzle. And so our hope is that this somehow was like us walking the razor's edge or us threading the needle of how to communicate what we thought was interesting and honest about our game to the audience of humans that we thought would be into it without alienating anyone who might be into it. That took us like 3 months. This is so stupid. It took us like 3 months to figure out that that was the interesting thing. But it helped a lot. Within like a week or two, Greg had designed this really cool website, playhundreds.com. It looks really good even on mobile phones. It's definitely inspired by the Spell Tower page. It's got this long scrolling layout. It tells you a little bit about the game style-wise, it tells you a little bit about the game gameplay-wise, but it doesn't have trailers on it or anything, and it has this kind of, there is a little bit of like a near future pharmaceutical weird science vibe, but it's very, very light, and it's mostly about this idea that this is a game that you can play, and you can relax while you play it, and you can meditate while you play it, And I honestly don't think that we would have built this site without spending 3 months thinking about the like one word or single sentence or single phrase distillation of how we were going to communicate this game that was worth communicating about, but we were having trouble doing it. And so when the site came out, the thing that we got is we would announce it and people would be like, whoa, check out this great game. It's Atom Atomic's new game. And we got a lot of tweets like that. But if you search for the right things, you would find these tweets that barely even mention the game. Like, it's there, but they're mostly just talking about like great HTML slash CSS. Like, nobody's ever said that for a game announcement that I've ever done before. Beautiful website explaining the mechanics of an intriguing. It doesn't even actually do that. It sort of does. It explains some of the game rules. It doesn't explain all the mechanics, but people kind of think it does. So that we think that sort of worked. We launched the site at the same time that the game debuted in the U.S. at IndieCade, where it was an official selection, and we got a bunch of press coverage. Some of it, only one of two people that did press coverage have actually played the game. Two of the people only saw the website and the long line to play it at IndieCade, and we're like, I guess it's interesting. We have 30 or 40 people in a press list already that are signed up. We don't even have promo codes for the game, but these are people who have emailed us and saying, when there's something to play, I've got to check this out. And so what we're hoping is that between the website and the website's effect on the press is that this will somehow be a way for us to reach out to this group of people who might actually be into this thing that we made. So that's our game. It's almost done. I have no idea when it's gonna come out. It might be good. And that's kind of it. But in a lot of ways, that's all that we can do anyway. We're a 3.5 or 4-person team. All we can do is try and make the game really good and try within our resources to tell people about it. And that's really all that we have control over. Like, we don't have control over whether it gets featured on iTunes. We don't have control over whether, even if it does get featured on iTunes, if other people will actually like it. These are all things that are completely outside of our control. But we feel pretty good about the things that were within our control, that even though we either did them wrong for a long time or we thought really hard about definitely doing them wrong publicly, we changed our minds. So for me, developing this game has been a lot about going down the wrong paths. Almost everything I showed you guys today is stuff that's not in the game anymore. And what's left, you know, I guess the thing, if I feel like we did anything right, it was not having great game design ideas, but it was about being patient enough after building the game ideas to wait and see if they were still good a week after we put them in. And we were willing to go through and just edit the crap out of our own work. And I feel like if we did nothing else right, if the game is a complete flop and it doesn't connect with anybody, I think I will still feel pretty good about the amount of editing that we did on this. I feel basically okay that it took us a year to do that, even though that was about 3 times longer than I wanted it to take. That's about all I have as far as prepared stuff. So I guess if anybody has any questions, I can take those now. And then as far as actually getting to play the game, I have it on my iPad. And if you find me around the festival, I'm here through late Friday night. And if you want to play it, just come and bug me, and I will hand you the iPad, and you can press on our circles and see if you like it or not. But yeah, I guess, any questions?
Were the, say, those original levels, I'll stand up because I'm very short. The first levels that you showed us, you said that you eventually, I think you said that you threw them away, but were they, was there much planning in them? I saw loads of writing that was in the page that was cut out of the picture.
The very first few levels that were designed are actually in the game in almost exactly the way that they were done on paper, and they were definitely planned, thought. But they were also kind of easy. I knew what were the most innocuous or the simplest types of things in the game are normal circles and these very simple obstacle circles that kind of act like a wall or a bumper. And I knew exactly how I wanted to teach that thing. And that process got the more complicated the game mechanics got, the more complicated that process got. And almost every series of introductory levels, even for the bubbles you pop, was changed drastically after the first idea or first version of them.
You say there were four of you working on this project. How many hours a week would you say that each of you put into this? And did you have other jobs at the same time?
It varied a lot. I think Scott Morgan's total time on the project was probably, I hope it was 2 weeks of normal work time, but spread out over weird hours at weird times of the day over a period of a few months. I doubt it was more than 2 weeks total. For Eric, it was a lot of time. Probably at least 40 to 50 hours a week for a lot of the past year. Mainly because we ended up but the game is so hyper-specific, and we've been so picky about it performing properly that the whole game engine has been written three times now. He's put in a pretty crazy amount of time into it. For me and Greg, I think I would guess that it's probably almost half that time. I think between Greg and I, we've probably put in close to the same amount of work hours-wise as Eric. And so part of that is I was doing things on the side, like making sure we were set up to do the Android Humble Bundle that Cannibalt was in, that made a huge difference in both Eric and I being able to continue to work on this. Greg was working on Gasketball while building this, and Scott was full-time at Radical. I actually built the Hunger Games while building this, Girl on Fire. So there definitely were things happening on the side. Usually that was at the cost of sleep and not so much at the cost of this game. I coded up a whole Cannibalt update in the middle of doing this just because it didn't seem like there was much for me to do especially during the third major rewrite of the game engine. We just kind of ran out of, it was like, well, we can't do new levels because the game engine's gonna be different later. And so I spent a bunch of time working on Cannibalt during then. So I would guess if we're gonna compute it in quote unquote man years, I would say it's probably somewhere in the neighborhood of about a two-man-year project, something like that, if that's helpful at all. That's my best guess anyway.
Forgive me for asking a personal question, but roughly how expensive was it to make a game like this?
It's a hard thing to calculate. It more or less boils down to, what were our living expenses? We don't have a super organized company with salaries that come out regularly necessarily. If we knew ahead of time that this was going to be a two-man-year project, and Eric and I both needed money to live and support our families and have healthcare and all of those things, I would put the cost at around probably like $80,000, maybe, something like that. Probably could be done for less, but there was never a time where we sat down with that amount of money and said, like, all right, here is our upfront investment on the table for this project. There was never a situation like that. Actually, probably it might be, the number might be lower or higher depending on what Greg was up to during this time too. But generally speaking, I think you'd say it's a two-man year game. Given that living expenses for us with our family healthcare plans and mortgages is somewhere around $40,000 a year. And so that would be my math for coming up with that number. I think that's probably, that's what we've depleted from our accounts while working on this instead of doing other things. For us, if it makes $0, that's gonna suck. But this was also kind of a really nice way to spend a year. I feel like I learned if what I did was spend $40,000 to learn all of the things I know now that I didn't know when I started this project, I would consider it completely worth it. Again, I would be disappointed, but I wouldn't write it off as a disaster or a loss or a reason to do it differently next time. I would still do the next game that was important to me the same way.
So quite obviously scale is quite important to the game, like how big the circles are, how big the playing space is. Was there ever any decision to make the game bigger or smaller, or specifically the size it is?
There was a little bit of like, the only math that was weird, so there's a basic rule of hundreds, which is a math rule, which is a circle that has 100 points on it that can only be as tall as the smallest dimension of the screen. So we kind of automatically know how big a circle can get to be, and we have a hard limit for that. The thing we didn't have a hard limit for was how small the circle should start, and that was just a matter of experimentation and feel and trying out some different things, and all the game math is automatic once you tell the game this is how big they should start, the amount of points that it allocates in order for it to smoothly grow up to that size is all kind of automatic. The place where this has become a problem is on the iPhone 5, where the aspect ratio is so sufficiently different from the iPad, where a circle that's as tall as the iPad is wide is almost as wide as the iPad is tall. On an iPhone 5, you can basically fit two circles side by side. So the actual playing field and all the puzzle design completely breaks. We haven't fixed that yet. We have ideas, and there are ideas that look good and fit in with the aesthetic of the game, but they haven't been implemented yet. So that's a huge hassle. But the interesting thing about the puzzles is the way circles behave in these enclosed spaces. So, yeah.
Did you all work separately from each other? Because you all had your own different commitments and stuff. Did you ever find it hard to communicate with each other?
Yeah. I work in, I live pretty close to downtown Austin in Austin, Texas. Eric lives about another 15 to 20 minutes out of town, kind of out in the countryside. Greg was mainly living and working in Baltimore, which is about 2,000 miles or 1,500 miles from Austin. And Scott Morgan was working out of Vancouver, which is just as far away from everything else. And it was definitely difficult. Like, if what I would say about it is, if you have the main thing it does is it exacerbates communication problems that already exist. So if you are in a collaboration. Like there's this guy, Paul Veer, here in the audience, who I've collaborated with multiple times before. And he lives and works in the Netherlands, and I live and work in the US. And we don't seem to have communication problems. I can send short, retarded emails, and Paul just kind of knows what I'm actually asking. And there's no problems there. When it's people that you're new, you're collaborating with them for the first time or whatever, it definitely gets tricky. And so for a while, we were actually really, really diligent for about the first half of production with having weekly Skype meetings because voice, I think, is a really, really good way of there's a lot that can be communicated by voice or by video that does not come across in email, and that is much, much more efficient than email. But yeah, I would say it was difficult at times, but I would definitely do it again. For me, if the choice is work with exactly the people that I want to work with, who have the exact skill sets that I love and whose work I have an enormous amount of respect for. If it means that sometimes I get a really confusing email and I have to send follow-up text messages or something to get a clarification, it's so completely worth it to me. Like places that ended up being tricky mostly had to do with our technology. So when we went down that horrible work hole about 6 months ago, where we basically just spent, there were tons of time and energy were being spent on things where there was no visible change in the game, even though there are really, really important fundamental underlying changes happening to the game. Stuff like that was really hard because we didn't know how long it was going to take to fix the technology. So we were having a really hard time scheduling things. And so we would have it was already a hard thing to communicate about because we get an email and be like, so how's it going? I have no idea. Okay, that's great. And if you're not in the same room with that person and you're not on the same task with them, it can be I think it can be really, really hard to actually understand all of the work that's going into, fixing this thing from the ground up in a way that it needs to be fixed. I think distance makes things that are already difficult more difficult, but it enables you to work with exactly the people who you want to work with, and that part I can't trade. I just refuse to. It comes down to this thing where if you're going to spend a year of your life and a whole bunch of your bank account making a thing, to me, I'll take some annoying emails once in a while as long as it means that I didn't have to make compromises on the thing itself.
I was just wondering, what programs did you use to make the game?
I think most of the art was originally designed in Adobe Illustrator, which is Greg's main art tool, I think. All of the programming was done in Xcode and Emacs. Eric's an Emacs guy. I'm super not. There were some mock-ups were done in Photoshop. A lot of animated mock-ups were done in Flash, like actual Flash Animation Studio or whatever. I don't know what Scott used to build the sounds. I assume it's something fancy and legitimate. I did a lot of sound sketching for this project. Like using SFXer or CFXer or whatever, a little like chip synthesizer thing and a free audio program called Audacity. and I would synthesize multiple sounds and then layer and distort them in Audacity to create a really, really bad version of what I wanted to have in the game, and then I would put it in the game and send it to Scott, and he would make the real version. That's most of what we used. A lot of Skype, a lot of Google Docs. That's it. Any other questions?
So I've heard John Blow talk about how calendar time was actually really important to his process for making Braid. And I'm getting that kind of impression from you that actually, although it kind of went over by some way to your original plan, that process of it going over was what shaped it to be what it is now. So do you take that as a lesson for future projects, that calendar time is important?
I have mixed feelings about this. So I am hesitant to look back on time spent and say, yes, every minute of that was definitely justified. I think there are gaps in this project for a variety of reasons, and not all of those gaps are good. Not all of our insights were gained with all of the extra time that we've had on it. But there are definitely, for myself, I need a certain amount of time between making a thing and editing it to edit it objectively. And one of the things that I'm trying to do as a designer is reduce that time and get it down as low as I can. You know, ideally, it would be 5 days or less. I think right now it's probably more like a month. But if I definitely have a hard time, depending on what it is, I have a hard time really honestly looking at something I made and going through and being able to just actually objectively chop off the bad parts, like actually look at it with fresh eyes. That's not something that should take 6 months to do, ideally. But it probably depends on the project and the size of what you're building and the importance of the thing that you ultimately decide you have to remove from the project in order for the project to be right, whatever that means. But I guess my answer would be, yeah, I think calendar time matters, but like even in the case of Braid, I'm not completely convinced that it definitely needed 3 years of casual part-time work in order to exist. Like, it probably could have been like 99% as awesome after about 2 years. And then that whole extra year would have been, you know, spent doing something else maybe. But I, you know, I'm definitely not qualified to say that for sure. That's my suspicion. Is that it? Cool. I guess I'll kill it. I didn't take like 15 minutes on accident instead of like the full hour or something, right? I don't have my timer going. Okay, I think that's good. I think I should probably be done. Thank you.